We have seen how to qualitatively analyze a nonlinear differential equation with the help of fixed points and null clients. And we have done a linear approximation around the fixed points in order to also get quantitative results. So far, we have considered the two-dimensional version of the logistic map with particular values for the coefficients. Now I want to look at variants of that, where we introduce parameters and then see how the dynamics of the system changes as we vary the parameters. First, I want to consider the reproduction rate of X. So this is our equation that we've considered before, but I've introduced, rather than a 1 here, I've introduced the reproduction rate epsilon 1 explicitly to be able to investigate the effect that it has on the dynamics. Again, we look for the null clients. We now see that the first null client of X, that depends on epsilon 1, while the null clients of Y do not. They are just the same as before. So, and like before, we can simply draw these into a graph. Now, as we vary epsilon 1, that means we're looking at this null client here, we see that the whole curve gets shifted up and down. The null client that I've drawn here is for a value of epsilon equals 1. And parallel to that are those with different epsilon values. So we see as we vary epsilon 1, the intersection between the y null client and the x null client moves back and forth. Yeah? If the reproduction rate is too low, like for 0.5 or even for 0.75, the y species dominates completely and the x species gets extinct. While for a reproduction rate of 1.5, it's the other way around. So changing the reproduction rate has quite a dramatic effect on the balance between these two species. Next, I consider a situation where the reproduction rate is fixed to 1. But I've added an external factor that reduces the population. And you can think of fishing, for instance. So fishing 10% of a population is easier if the population is large than if it is small. So therefore, the fishing factor here depends on the population itself. The null climb then becomes this one here. Actually, we set the differential equation again to zero, and we get the new null climb. Now here we see that for x equals zero, nothing changes. Y always assumes the value of one. But the slope at which the null climb decreases changes depending on phi. For increasing phi, so I assume phi to be positive, so that there is actually some fishing. For positive phi, for increasing phi, the null climb gets steeper and steeper. So I first draw in the original null climb for phi equals zero. And then for phi equals one, for instance, the slope would be twice as steep. So rather than one, you have one plus one equals two. So the null climb would look like this. And for phi equals 3, it would go through 1 quarter. So we see that also in this case, the fixed point in the center, so the stable balance between the two species, moves around. But no matter how much you do fishing, you can never extinct the population X. In the next example, I combine the growth rate or reproduction rate as a parameter with the fishing. And I've done this here with a rho parameter, which actually is the reproduction parameter, and then inserting it in a way that 1/2, 1/2 remains a fixed point. So down here you see the null climbs. So here if you look at the x null climb, you see that by setting x to zero, the crossing of the null climb with the y-axis corresponds to rho, and the steepness is then such that the null climb cuts through 1/2, 1/2, because if you put in 1/2 here, this cancels out with a 2, you get 1/2 here. Now the rho cancels with the rho here, so you're left with plus 1/2. So for rho equals 1, the null climb simply is the same as before. For rho equals 1/2, we get this horizontal null climb. And for rho equals 3/4, the null climb sits right on top of the y null climb. Now something interesting happens. The fixed point stays where it was, but the x null climb once is steeper than the y null climb, and then for smaller values it's actually less steep. So the crossing is sort of comes in two different ways. Now, what does that mean for the dynamics? Well, we have seen in our earlier analysis that the sine of y dot or x dot on the one side or the other side of the null clients can tell you something about the dynamics. We know that the dynamics is vertical on the x null clients and horizontal on the y null clients. And the direction in which it goes, whether it goes to the left or to the right, can be inferred from the other null client. So we know x dot equals 0 here, and in our earlier analysis we have found that x dot is less than 0 here and greater than 0 here. The way to see this is to go into the null client and set the x to a value where this is 0. I mean, this is positive right now, right? This is 0. And now if you increase x a little bit, you see if you make it larger, because this is positive. Oh, I didn't mention that, right? So this part should be positive. So rho should be greater than 1/2. Yeah, so this is positive. We have a negative sign here. So if x gets a little bit larger, then we get a negative derivative, time derivative. Yeah, and that means, now you should use different colors. That means if I consider this null client, then the horizontal dynamics on the y null client goes to the left, right? So x dot is less than 0. So it goes to the left here and it goes to the right here. Likewise, y dot is less than 0 on that side, and y dot is greater than 0 on the lower side. So therefore, this dynamics goes down. And here it goes up. However, if we consider the other null client, this one for instance, for that one, we also find, like before, x dot equals 0 here, and if you go a little bit higher, x dot is less than 0, and a little bit lower, x dot is greater than 0. So, since now the y null client is in this region above the x null client, the horizontal dynamics goes to the left because x dot is less than 0. While down here it goes to the right because x dot is greater than 0. The corresponding dynamics on the x null client, so now I'm talking about this here, is also reversed, right? So you're on the right side, this is above the y null client, so therefore the dynamics goes down. While you're on the left side, it goes up. Now this has quite dramatic consequences for the dynamics. So if you consider the light blue dynamics, so for the steep x null climb, you could find a trajectory like this one, for instance, or this one, or this one. So it converges to this fixed point. While for the pink dynamics, we see that, for example, if you start here, it would go up here to this point. Or if you start here, it would actually diverge. Because for rho equals 1/2, if you plug this in here, you have 1 minus 1. So this term has no effect. So there's no limiting factor. So therefore, the species would grow indefinitely. It's interesting to see that now there are two outcomes, namely either the X species grows and grows and grows and Y gets extinct, or Y grows and X gets extinct. Now, Y can't grow indefinitely, while for rho equals 1/2, we have seen X can grow indefinitely. But if rho is slightly larger than 1/2, this null cline would have a small negative slope, and then there would be a fixed point somewhere. So here we have mainly considered the fourth fixed point. There are three other ones. One is here, one is here, and one is here. So you see, you can do the qualitative analysis also if you have parameters in the system that change the qualitative behavior. You have to look at the null clines and how they change along with the parameters, and then see what consequences that has for the dynamics. But like before, we can go even a step further and do a quantitative analysis of a fixed point under the changing parameter. And that's what I want to do next for the fixed point 1/2, 1/2. First, we linearize the differential equation around a fixed point. And remember, since this is a fixed point, the constant term vanishes in this linearization. So what we get is so this here is the derivative of this term with respect to x, which would be, since you have two factors here, the derivative of this with respect to x, so just 1 times this, which is this one here, and then this times the derivative of this, and the derivative of this with respect to x is just minus 2 rho minus 1, that is this minus 2 rho minus 1, and then multiplied with x, with this x. And likewise, you can derive the others as derivatives of y, x dot and y dot with respect to x and y. Now, if we define the auxiliary variables, we can rewrite this as so this here is simply all this, with x0 and y0 replaced by 1/2. And then we see that this term here appears here a second time, so we can drop the 1/2. We can drop this term and this 1/2. then this rho minus 2 rho is minus rho, and plus 1 minus 1 half is plus 1 half. Now this 1 half term minus 1 half term is simply this minus x0. Put this in here. And also here, minus 1 half times 1 half is minus 1 quarter. And here again, minus 1 half. And this again allows us to write the equation in vector notation. After linearizing the differential equation around the fixed point, the next step is to look at the matrix of the linear differential equation and investigate the eigenvalues, because they tell us something about the qualitative behavior at this fixed point. The eigenvalues of the linearized dynamics, i.e. the eigenvalues of matrix A, can be obtained by setting the characteristic polynomial to zero. So that second formulation makes clear that the argument of the square root can never become negative. So we won't have imaginary or complex eigenvalues. Let us now see what that means for the stability of the fixed point. In order to see how the dynamics depends on the parameter, we have to see how the eigenvalue changes with the parameter. So we need a plot somehow of the eigenvalues as a function of the parameter rho. Down here we see that the argument of the square root is always positive. So this is always a real value, and it's a positive real value. So minus rho minus the square root is always a negative value. So that's the first insight. Lambda, let's call it lambda minus as the eigenvalue with a negative sign here. So lambda minus is always negative. And that is good if you're interested in stable fixed points. Now, the second one is a bit trickier because we have a negative rho and then a positive square root here. So we have to see which term dominates. One way to visualize this is to plot rho and then trying to plot this square root. So this is the first term, namely rho. And I've plotted it positively because then we can look at the differences between the functions. That's easier than looking at the sums of functions. So this is rho. And now the question is, how does the second term look? Now we see it's a standard parabola, actually. So this part is a standard parabola centered at 1 and then shifted up by 1/2. Now this would be the standard parabola. Now if we take the square root, we notice that for large rho values, the minus 1 and the plus 1/2 can be neglected. So for large rho values, rho squared and then taking the square root of that would just lead to rho. Right? Or rather, actually we don't ignore the minus 1, we keep the minus 1, but we ignore the plus 1/2. And if we ignore that one, then the square root cancels with the square, and we simply get the absolute value of rho minus 1. Now, for rho equals 1, this is 0, and we simply have the square root of 1 over 2, which is roughly 0.7. Let's say that's here. And we've just argued that for large rho, it approaches these linear functions that I've drawn in light blue. So overall, this function looks like this. And we see that it intersects with the rho line here. And this is roughly at 3 over 4. Now if we plug in the 3 over 4 into this eigenvalue here, we find that we get 3 over 4 minus 1, which is 1 over 4, squared would be 1 over 16, plus 1/2, meaning plus 8 over 16, gives us 9 over 16. Now the square root of 9 over 16 is 3 over 4. And this cancels out exactly with this minus rho here on the left side. So at a value of for rho of 3 over 4, we have an eigenvalue 0. And as we go more to the right, the eigenvalue becomes negative, and as we go to the left, we get positive eigenvalues. So we have positive lambda plus on the left side and negative lambda plus on the right side. And positive eigenvalues always indicate an unstable fixed point. So we see this analysis shows us that for rho equals 3 over 4, we would have an indifferent fixed point. For larger rho, we have negative eigenvalues. Both eigenvalues are negative, so the fixed point should be stable. For smaller rho, we have one positive eigenvalue, which makes the fixed point unstable. Now let us see whether that is consistent with what we have found before. As we see here, the qualitative analysis based on the null clients actually also showed that for rho equals 3 over 4, we have an indifferent situation where sort of the two null clients lie on top of each other and any point here would be a fixed point. And that for larger values, we get a stable dynamics, and for smaller values, we have seen that the dynamics diverges either or actually goes to a different fixed point than the one that we've analyzed. So this analysis also makes clear the fact that we show that this one particular fixed point is unstable doesn't mean that the whole dynamics is unstable. That would be true in the linear system, but in a nonlinear system, it can simply converge to a different fixed point, right? So actually, you would have to look at various fixed points. Okay, so we get a pretty consistent picture of how the system behaves as rho varies. So we have seen that you can analyze a system also if it contains parameters that may change, and you can see for which ranges of parameters the system might be stable or unstable. You can do this either qualitatively as before with a null client analysis, or you can look at the linearized version of the fixed points and then look at the eigenvalues of the corresponding matrix. Now, at the end, I would like to leave you with two questions. Question number one, if you want to kill a parasite population, is it better to kill many of them or reduce their reproduction rate? I mean, if you kill all of them, of course, then you got rid of them. But if you can't quite kill all of them, should you put effort in there? Or if you have the opportunity to also change the reproduction rate, might that be a good strategy? And I ask that assuming that the species competes against another species. Question number two, can you invent an interaction between two species such that the populations oscillate? We have seen before that we had eigenvalues, real eigenvalues, so that leads to either stable convergence to a fixed point or a divergence. But would it be possible to also invent an interaction between species that leads to an oscillation of the population? And a famous example that this actually happens in nature are the lynx and snowshoe hare in Canada.